Hi guys, welcome to module 11. In this module, we're going to talk about analytics and the concept of views. So let's try to understand what we mean by analytics. Data is created as our application is used by our application or by the users of our application. And this data might require further analysis. So just to give you an example, in the application that we created where we were looking at users and articles, we might need reports for how many users have signed up, when did these users sign up, how many articles have been written, what the most popular categories and tags are. So this kind of information and obtaining this kind of information falls under the purview of what we call analytics. Analytics might be important for the organization for doing further development on the application to understand what features are being used and what features are being desired by users. It might be important for the organization from a business point of view. Analytics is also useful when we need to add some features to our applications. For example, if you want to show a list of the popular categories and tags on the homepage, doing the analytics to find out what the popular categories and tags would be very useful. So far, the data models that we've had can store the user information and the article information, but there are no data models that we have in a database that allow us to fetch analytics information. For example, if you want to get the information for how many articles have been written by each author, we don't really have a table in our database that is something like the article count table that contains two columns called author ID and article count. If we had that table, then we would be able to query that table. We would be able to insert data into that table to how many articles have been written by an author, and we would be able to query that table whenever we wanted analytics for seeing how many articles have been written by an author. But if you think about it, this is redundant information, right? The article count table is actually just a kind of a duplicate or a summary of the information that is already there in the article table. And that is what we're going to understand in this module. The fact that the data that is required for analytics can just be derived from the primary normalized data that we were storing in our data models. So let's look at two ways of obtaining analytics information from the primary data models that we already have. Two class of actions that fall into creating information that is ready for analytics is called aggregation and denormalization. So an aggregation is when we take existing data and we summarize it in a way that is ideal for further statistical analysis. So for example, we can aggregate the article table to create the article underscore count table, right? Because the article table contains the primary information, and doing some kind of a summarization or aggregating the data from that table can give us exactly the information that we need. Denormalizing is the process of taking information that spans multiple tables, putting them together into one table. This act of putting them together in one table is not necessarily useful by itself, but is useful especially when further aggregations need to be done. So for example, we can take the article, category and tags, which were three separate tables, we can merge it into one table, and then after merging it into one table, we can apply an aggregation on it to find out, let's say, what the most popular tags that an author uses are. So this process of bringing data together into one table is called denormalizing. So let's look at an example of what we've been talking about. Here we have the article table, which contains the ID, title, content, author ID and category column. What we want out of this table is that we want the information for which author has written how many articles. So this is the target information that we want on the right. We want the author ID and we want to know a count of the articles that each author ID has written. So we can see that we want author ID 1 was 3 articles, author ID 2 was 1 article. This process of getting to this data is called an aggregation. So we are summarizing the content of this table and we're getting this information. We've already explored that we can get this information by doing a select query. And the select query we have tried out in one of the previous modules. What we have now done is that we've created a view out of the select query. So that means now there's suddenly a new kind of table that has been created, which is an aggregation or a summary of the table that it came from. So SQL views are table-like entities that have been created by performing aggregations or denormalizations or maybe just simple select queries from a table or from a set of existing tables. It is important to note that this table-like entity that has been created by a view is not actually a table. This data is not actually stored on disk. If we ever want to query rows from this view, the entire select query will actually be computed to get the rows from this table-like entity. And because this table-like entity is actually temporary, it is not actually stored on disk, this is called a view. Why do we want to create another view and not another table? Because we want this table to derive all of its data from this table. That means we would always like to write, update, insert into this table, right? And as soon as we update this table, we would want to read from this view to get the information that is required for our analytics, right? Which is why this is not actually a new table. If you make an update to our table, right, where we added a new row, for example, article ID 10 has been added, which is written by the author ID 2, instantly the view is also modified. And so now if we query data from this view, you will notice that the author ID 2 now has a count of 2. So to summarize, an SQL view is exactly like a table, is technically implemented by the DBMS as just another select query. So the advantages of having views are quite clear. The disadvantage is that because the data is not really on disk, it needs to be computed every time. And that means that if we have very large tables, converting them into views to fetch the information that we want might become expensive. If you think about this in a little more detail, when we did the data modeling for actually creating and storing our data, our bias was to create a schema or a set of data models that reduce redundancy and that increase the amount of integrity that we have. This process of trying to achieve a higher level of integrity and lower amount of redundancy is called normalization. However, we understand that we can always derive the data that we have from our normalized tables into views that can help us, that will make analytics applications much easier. However, if the load on the database is already very high, then adding extra analytics queries to the mix might not be a very good idea. For example, if we have a few tens of millions of rows in our article table, computing this view every single time might not be very efficient. In which case, some databases give us the option of snapshotting the view and actually storing it to disk so that it can be queried. So this process is called materializing the view. And so we are materializing a portion of our data and storing that onto disk. The advantage of materializing, querying the materialized view becomes very efficient because the data does not have to be computed every single time, especially if the computation is expensive. But the disadvantage is that the data is not live anymore. That means that if our primary tables are updated, then we have to refresh our materialized view to be able to get the latest info. When we materialize data from an existing set of tables, we don't have to store it in the same database. We can even store it in a completely different database. So for example, a very common pattern is to use an SQL database or a relational database like PostgreSQL as a primary database because of the support that it has for transactions and for asset properties. But to materialize information from that database into another database like MongoDB or Elasticsearch to enable analytics or search-like features. The important things to take away from this module are that SQL is a very useful tool for analytics because we can make all sorts of queries to compute exactly the data that we want. We understood that aggregations are a way to represent statistical summaries of the data. The third thing we understood is that denormalization is the process of getting data from multiple tables and putting that into one table. And we did not look at an example of denormalization, but we understand how denormalization can help, especially in doing further aggregation. We also looked at the concept of SQL views and how SQL views can be used to create table-like entities that are very useful for analytics. We understood that we can use aggregations and denormalizations to create SQL views. We also touched upon the concept of materialized views. It is important to understand that several concepts that we've covered in this module are not exclusive to the analytics domain alone. For example, aggregations or denormalizations and materialized views are also concepts that become useful when we talk about read performance. So the purpose of this module was to just touch upon a few basic concepts that will come in handy when we take our first steps with analytics.